What's the best chipset on a phone right now? On this table, we have the Pixel 10 Pro with Tensor G5, the iPhone 17 Pro Max with A19 Pro, the Xiaomi 17 Pro Max sporting the Snapdragon 880 Generation 5, the Vivo X300 Pro running on Dimensity 9500, and finally the Galaxy Z Flip 7 sporting Exynos 2500. And I'm gonna tell you, the result is quite surprising. The first test I'm running is exporting a 4K YouTube video in CapCut. All of them are doing it in 1080 at 30 frames per second. Exporting a 4K video is something I do very often, especially when I want to upload a video to YouTube Shorts or TikTok. For some reason, the MediaTek Dimensity 9500 was super fast, and I was quite surprised. I don't know what magic trick they used, but this task was done in 38 seconds. I put both the Vivo and Xiaomi phones in performance mode, by the way. The iPhone with the A19 Pro was the second phone to finish the task at 1 minute and 36 seconds. It's slightly faster than the Snapdragon, which finished at 1 minute and 54 seconds. It is not surprising that the Exynos and Tensor took longer. Also, one important caveat is that the Philips phones are never the best choice to test chipset performance because of the form factor. But this year, Samsung only released the Z Flip with this chipset. Regardless, the Exynos finished the task in 2 minutes and 40 seconds, still faster than the Google Pixel, which finished in 2 minutes and 57 seconds, almost double the time it took from iPhone to do the same thing. For this round, the Dimensity won by a big margin, and I'm sure it is not just about the chipset, but also software optimization and maybe even some codecs. Then comes the Apple A19 Pro, followed by Snapdragon, Exynos, and Tensor. For the second task, I decided to export 50 images in Adobe Lightroom with a watermark. The iPhone quickly started to take the lead, but the Dimensity and Snapdragon were close behind. Usually, Adobe software works very well with the iPhone, so it was not surprising that the iPhone A19 Pro finished first at 2 minutes and 8 seconds. Just a few seconds later, the Dimensity took second place and finished at 2 minutes and 26 seconds. Then, the Snapdragon finished at 2 minutes and 55 seconds. It took the Tensor G5 4 minutes and 16 seconds, this time faster than the Exynos, which finished the task at 4 minutes and 23 seconds. If you look at the results, the A19 Pro got first place, followed by the Dimensity, which is doing really well so far, then Snapdragon, Tensor, and finally Exynos. Also measure the display's maximum temperature, and the iPhone was the coolest with only 29 degrees Celsius, which is 84 degrees Fahrenheit. The Dimensity, Snapdragon, and Tensor phones had similar temperatures, but the Galaxy Exynos got much hotter, likely due to the form factor of the flip phone. To test CPU performance more uniformly, I ran the Geekbench CPU benchmark, which is designed exactly for that. On this benchmark, you can see two results, single core and multi-core. On single core, the best score went to the A19 Pro. Snapdragon got second place, followed by Dimensity, then Exynos, and Google Tensor G5 was last. For multi-core, the order was different. The Snapdragon got first place and exceeded the 10K mark, which is insane performance for a phone. The Dimensity got second place, followed by the Apple A19 Pro, then Exynos, and again Tensor in last place. To test the gaming performance, the best benchmark right now is to run 3D Mark, which gives the average FPS and also a final score based on the number of frames generated. There are two tests on this benchmark that can be interesting. The first one is the Solar Bay Extreme, which tests the graphics and also ray tracing. I ran only one loop of this test, and the result was interesting. First of all, the Pixel was not able to finish the task since it doesn't support the libraries, I guess. The iPhone came on top with a really high score of 2088. Then the MediaTek Dimensity got second place, followed by Snapdragon 8 Elite, and then Exynos was not far behind in this specific test. So far, it seems all three top dogs are doing shoulder to shoulder. For the next test, I ran Wildlife Extreme Stress Test. This test runs a game loop 20 times, each loop taking around 20 minutes and pushing the phones to do the heavy work under an extended amount of time. This basically forces each phone to throttle. For this test, we are looking for two important metrics. One of them is the maximum performance in the first loop, and the second is which phone did better sustain performance, which you can see by the lowest score and also the chart. Also, I should mention a very important caveat in this test. The lowest score has a lot to do with how the specific phone handles throttling. Some phones throttle at lower temperatures like 40 degrees Celsius, which is 104 Fahrenheit, while some other phones like Xiaomi throttles much later at 50 degrees Celsius, which is 122 degrees Fahrenheit. That means the phone will have a higher lower score, even though it is not just about the chipset, but also about the fact that the phone simply didn't slow things down. Here is the result for the highest score, which basically is the first loop. The MediaTek got the highest score by a good margin, then the Snapdragon got second place, the iPhone A19 Pro got third, followed by Exynos, and finally Tensor. For stability, the Snapdragon got the better score, mainly due to the fact that Xiaomi 17 Pro Max throttled much later than the Vivo X300 Pro and iPhone 17 Pro Max. The second place was for the A19 Pro, followed closely by the Dimensity. The Tensor G5 and Exynos also didn't do great here, since, once again, the Philips phones don't have the best thermals because all the brain is in the half of the phone. For the next benchmark, I ran AnTuTu. AnTuTu is a great benchmark because it not only tests the chipset but also graphics and a bunch of other things. At the same time, unfortunately, it is not cross-platform, so the scores for iOS are not comparable to the scores you get on the Android devices. Therefore, I'm not going to include this result in our final score. But since you may be interested in Android phones, the Dimensity got the best score. It got more than 3.5 million, which is crazy. The Snapdragon got second place. The Exynos surprisingly did better than Tensor, even though the smaller form factor is rather limiting on such a heavy benchmark, and Google Tensor G5 got the last place. There are a few ways to look at the results. One is by which phone got the most number of wins. If we look at it this way, the Apple A19 Pro gets first place because it won 3 out of 7 rounds. The Snapdragon 8 Elite and Dimensity 9500 won 2 out of 7 each. The other way we can rank them is that I gave 4 points to the phone with the highest score and 0 to the one that comes last. This way, Apple again wins with 22 points, the Dimensity 9500 gets 2nd place with 21 points, the Snapdragon 8 Elite Generation 5 gets 3rd place with 20 points, and then we have Exynos and Tensor. But I personally think the best way to do a final ranking is by doing a weighted score based on the exact performance they achieved. If you do it this way, Apple again wins with 6.5 points, the Snapdragon 8 Elite Generation 5 gets 2nd this time with 6.3 points, then we have the MediaTek Dimensity with 6.1 points, followed by Exynos with 4.3 points, and Tensor with a disappointing 3.1 points. This shows that you can't go wrong with choosing any phone with the Apple A19 Pro, Snapdragon 8 Elite Generation 5, or Dimensity 9500. You'd probably only get the Exynos one if you really want a flip phone anyway, and it is probably better not to get a Pixel if you do gaming, video editing, or any other heavy task. If you enjoyed this video and want to see a comparison of the best compact phones of the year, you can watch this video next. Thanks for tuning into Tecmo, and I will see you in the next one.